Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Sherry Capello.
Number two.
My name is Sherry Capello.
Number three.
My name is Sherry Capello.
Only one of these people is the real Sherry Capello, and is the only one sworn to tell the truth. Now, let's meet our panel. Co-star of Murder, She Wrote, Ron Mazak. Emmy Award-winning actress and producer, Polly Bergen. Film and television producer, David Niven Jr. And to tell the truth's very own, Kitty Carlisle. Here's the host of To Tell the Truth, Gordon Elliott.
Thank you, and welcome, and good morning, panel. You look tremendous.
Thank you.
Ron.
Howdy, Gordon.
Last time I saw somebody in an outfit like that, Roy and Dale and a horse were nearby.
Are you talking to David, or are you talking to me?
I'm talking to you. Sorry. Okay, hang on. One, two, three for David. Let's get right to the story presented by our first team of challengers, all three of whom claim to be Sherry Capello, and here is her story. Please read along with me. I, Sherry Capello, was fired because they said I was too fat. I was a flight attendant. I was awarded my 25-year service pin, and ironically, on the same day, I also got a pink slip. The reason? I was 11 pounds overweight. I was mortified. A passenger never refused a meal tray because I was too fat, nor would a passenger refuse my help in jumping out of a burning plane because of my weight. I decided to fight back. I filed a suit charging age and sex discrimination. I believe it's the company's attempt to force senior flight attendants with higher salaries and benefits into early retirement. My appearance has nothing to do with my proficiency. As vice president of the Association of Professional Flight Attendants Union, I refuse to go back to the days when all flight attendants were expected to look like sex bunnies. Signed, Sherry Capello. Hearty rounds of applause from the women, I notice. Welcome, ladies, and we'll find out more about this weighty problem after this. Don't go. Welcome back to Tell the Truth, and panel, these three people all claim to be Sherry Capello, who was fired because she was nothing more than 11 pounds overweight. So let's start the questioning with Kitty Carlisle.
Thank you. Number one, what year was this?
1989.
And number two, what company was it?
Number two, I'm sorry, did you meet American Airlines?
And number three, is there anything is too fat ever? I mean, are there any limits?
Yes, we have standards, Metropolitan Life Standards from 1959.
And number one, were those standards adhered to, or were they not?
Oh, they were adhered to.
And what were the standards? How much did you have to weigh?
For my height, I could not weigh any more than 129 pounds.
And number, what is your height?
5'5".
And number two, is there any...
Sorry, Kitty, we've got to move along to David.
Number one, do they have the same rules for the stewards?
They do, but their weights are much higher for their height than they are for the females.
All right, number two, if you were 11 pounds overweight, could the same problem occur if you were 11 pounds underweight?
No.
All right. Number three, as a matter of interest, what was the outcome of the suit that you filed?
Well, it's in court now. There is no outcome until we get further along in the process.
Number one, what are you looking for as the outcome of the suit?
I am looking for a reasonable policy to be set by the airline to allow people to continue their jobs and not be fired for discrimination.
All right.
A nicely put phrase, although a political announcement somewhat. Polly.
Number three, you talk about jumping out of a burning plane. What happens if a plane lands and there's an emergency? How do passengers get out of a plane?
Well, first of all, we tell them not to get excited and calm them down, and then we have the slides that come out the door.
I see. Number one, in working for American Airlines, is there any age limit for stewardesses today?
Not any longer.
No longer any age limit.
No.
Number two, is there a height limit?
No.
Number three.
And finally, Ron Masek.
You said no passenger ever refused the help from getting out of a burning plane. Number one, were you ever in a burning plane?
No.
Number two, you said you file a suit charging age and sex discrimination. What does that have to do with weight?
Well, it's a class action suit that I'm filing for, and part of the suit is because of the age, and I really feel that that's one of the reasons why I was let go. They happened to say it was weight, but I feel there's more to it, so there's a lot more to the lawsuit.
Number three, number two said it was American Airlines. Is it American Airlines?
Yes.
And have you been with American Airlines for 25 years,
yes,
number three?
Yes, I have.
Number one, you have been 25 years
with, yes,
American Airlines? Okay, as the, what did they tell you actually, number two, was the reason?
I was 11 pounds overweight.
So, okay.
Okay, Ron, we'll leave it there. Time is up. Time to vote now for either number one, number two, or number three. Our team of challengers will receive $500 for each incorrect vote with a guarantee of $1,000. And if the panel is fooled completely, the team will receive $3,000. Now, panel, if you're ready to cast your ballots. Okay, Polly, we're not ready yet. Take five. Okay, you're ready now.
All right.
Okay. I say, Kitty, for whom did you vote?
Oh, well, I didn't think it was number three because she said that thing just goes out if there's a burning. You always hear the same words, you know, the chute will, and you don't sit on
That's
the
right.
edge, and you jump, and all of that stuff. And number one looks very much as though she might be the real one. But number two looks like an organizer to me, and she talked about class action, and that had the ring of authenticity.
Okay, number two from Kitty. David, your thoughts?
I agree about the class action comment for number two. However, I think that number one regarding, it sounded like an authoritative sort of person who probably would be a vice president of the Association of Professional Flight Attendants Union. So there.
Number one. Okay. I won't make any comment. Let's hope for you, David. Polly.
Well, I really thought they were all wonderful. It was very difficult between one and two, and I really, I leaned toward two, and then at the very last minute, I don't know why, I switched to one because, because it looked to me as though she was slightly older and that there might be an age discrimination thing there. And I also commiserated with her because I'm the same height and the same weight.
All right. And finally, Ron Masek.
I am totally convinced that Mr. Goodson and his entire staff have sent Polly to haunt us. For all of the same reasons and none of the above.
You're right.
I selected number two. She sounded like she was really angry.
Well, the votes are in, as you can see. Two votes for number one. Two votes for number two. Nothing for number three. This has never turned out well for us this week. Okay, now for the moment of truth. Will the real Sherry Capello please stand up?
No, it's not right.
Oh! I'm so happy for David.
Oh, so
yay! Yeah, so is David. We're happy for you, Sherry, of course, as well. I can't believe that. That you made the expression back to the days when you expected to look like sex bunnies. Is that the only airline that has this attitude, or are all airlines the same mind?
There are several airlines that have no weight standards whatsoever. United, Continental, Northwest.
If you're good at your job, you stay.
That's right. And all of the other airlines have an increase as you age, if they do have a standard.
Which is,
except
which
for
of course,
America.
Sensible. And you have more to offer, 25 years experience, of course.
Most definitely.
Okay. Now, number two, your real name and identity.
My name is Dee Anderson Green, and I'm a real estate loan officer.
And number three, your real name and occupation.
My name is Sunday Merrick, and I'm a fortune teller and a belly dancer.
Stick around. We may have some more for you. Okay. Well, there were two incorrect votes at $500 a vote, so you receive $1,000. And thanks for being with us today, to tell the truth. And we'll be back with a man who was late for his own funeral right after this. Welcome back. You are watching To Tell the Truth, and let's meet our next team of challengers.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Bill Adamack.
Number two.
My name is Bill Adamack.
Number three.
My name is Bill Adamack.
All right, panel, these three people all claim to be Bill Adamack, and here is his story. Read along with me, if you like. I, Bill Adamack, was late for my own funeral. I was out duck hunting when I got lost in the frozen wilderness of Canada. I waited for 3 days to be rescued, but no one came. I was shivering, hungry, and desperate, and decided to try to make it on foot. When a caribou crossed my path, I shot it and ate it raw. I managed to cross a river on a floating chunk of ice. It was a terrifying ride, but I finally made it across the raging waters. After 15 agonizing days, I staggered home. My friends thought they were seeing a ghost. Everyone thought I was dead. They had even given me a funeral. I was told they said some wonderful things about me. I'm sort of sorry I missed it. But one thing I didn't miss out on was the birth of my child. My baby son was born a few weeks after I got home. Signed, Bill Adamack. Well, welcome home, gentlemen. Please take a seat, relax, and we'll start the questioning with Ron Masak.
Number one, you got lost in the frozen part wilderness of Canada. What part of Canada were you lost in?
I was lost north of Coppermine.
Number two, it said you were shivering. What did you do to stay warm?
Walked a lot.
Walked a lot? And when you shot the caribou and you ate it raw, what does a caribou taste like raw? Number three.
Caribou kind of has a taste all its own. It really doesn't, it's not familiar to any other meat I've ever eaten.
Number one, when you were going across the water, where were you trying to get to on that?
I was trying to get back to the other side of the river so I could get back home.
So number two.
Where was he trying to get to? Home. Polly.
Number two, what is a caribou?
It's an animal like a deer.
Number one, how did you get lost? I mean, was it a storm or what?
Well, yes. I went out duck hunting, went to the duck blind, and a fog rolled in, and I got on my snowmobile, and I thought I was going to make it back home. I became disoriented. I went further north. I went almost 63 miles away from my duck blind.
Oh, my gosh. And number three, what is a decoy made of?
It's usually made of plastic and wood.
Moving along now to David Niven, Jr.
Thank you. Number one, it says here that you managed to cross the river on a floating chunk of ice. How did you hold on to this ice?
Very carefully. I took my rain gear off that I had. I put it on the floe of ice because at that time the river is breaking up. It was around June 2nd. I just hung on and I said, oh, I've got to get across here.
All right, number two, are you Canadian?
Yes.
Number three, if you are not Canadian, what were you doing in Canada?
I went up there to work in Yellowknife in a gold mine up there. I'm originally from Colorado.
Okay, and
Kitty Carlisle.
Number two, I'm confused about your return. And number one said you came out in a snowmobile. Did you come out in a snowmobile to go duck hunting?
Yes, I was riding a snowmobile.
And number three, what happened to the snowmobile then?
I was traveling along for about 3 days and ran out of gas.
Oh, and then you went on foot?
That's correct.
Number one, when you crossed the ice, did you think of little Eva?
Little who?
Little Eva in Uncle Tom's Cabin, who fled on the ice.
Well,
no, you obviously didn't.
I'm not familiar with that.
Number two.
It wouldn't be the first thing in my mind either. Polar bears, I think, would be more relevant. Big Eva would be more appropriate. And it's time to vote for either number one, and number two, or number three. The panel, if you're ready to cast your ballots, we'll begin with Ron. For whom did you vote?
Watch how dumb this answer is. I eliminated number one because I figure I don't care how disoriented you are. If you walk 63 miles out of your way, you know you're going the wrong way. Number three said that he ran out of gas, and I can't see a hunter running out of gas if he's going to take a snowmobile into the woods. And something about number two, I detected maybe just a little bit of a Canuck in his sound.
Mm-hmm.
A boot and a root and a doot.
Okay, number two, Polly.
Well, but he took the snowmobile. He didn't know he needed all that gasoline.
I didn't say it made any logic.
He didn't expect to go 63 miles. He got lost in a storm. But anyway, I hope you're wrong because I voted for number three. I mean, he wasn't going on around the world.
It's okay,
you know?
Polly. It's all right, Polly. It's okay.
Okay.
It's okay. Polly. It's all right, David.
I don't agree with either of your reasons, but I understand it. But however, number one was absolutely brilliant in his answering and his description of how to cling on to the flowing ice cube.
And only someone who could do it would be able to tell you.
Exactly.
And Kitty.
Oh, well, I didn't believe him for a minute with all that business about his raincoat and all that.
Reindeer.
He said he put his raincoat.
And, no, coat and his reindeer. That's right.
Oh, he had a reindeer. Well, I missed that. Terribly sorry, number one. I voted for number three.
All right, now let's find out. A good spread, a good selection this time, panel. One vote for number one, one vote for number two, two votes for number three. Now let's find out who the real Nanook of the North is. Will the real Bill Adamack please stand up?
Number two.
Ah, yeah. You got it. Yeah. And it was that little suggestion of an accent, wasn't it? Now, Bill, was there at any time you thought you were going to die, the funeral would have been an appropriate moment?
Yes, when I was hanging on to the ice going across the river, that's the only time that I thought I might not make it.
And your wife thought you were dead. She was going to have your young son. What did she say when she saw you?
She cried a lot. She's not too happy about me traveling alone anymore.
Okay. Now, I think one risk is enough, but congratulations. Good to see you hearty and well. Number one, what's your real name and occupation?
My name is Bill Sorensen. I raise turkeys, and I'm an Iowa corn farmer.
Number three, your real name and occupation?
My name is Max Kredich, and I'm a graphics artist, and I design Yellow Page ads.
Little Ben, you're a duck blind in his life. Three incorrect votes at $500 a vote, so your team receives $1,500. But more importantly, we thank you for coming on to Tell the Truth today. Thank you very much. We'll be back to play one-on-one with someone from our studio audience right after this. Welcome back to the Tell the Truth, and now it's time to play one-on-one with someone from our studio audience. Burton, who do you have for us today?
Well, Gordon, today we have Sandra Thomas from Altadena, California.
Hello, Sandra. Good to meet you. Thanks for coming along. Here's your chance to play one-on-one. I want you to meet a lady with two stories to tell, Maggie Patterson. Welcome, Maggie. Now, Maggie's going to tell us two stories, only one of which is the truth, Sandra. If you can spot the true story, you'll win $500. Ooh. Maggie, what's your first story?
I'm an artist. I create award-winning sculptures out of lint for my clothes dryer.
Okay, now that may or may not be the truth, but you can try and listen to Maggie's second story to see if that may be. Maggie?
If you want to feed your dog in style, come to me. I run the world's only drive-through restaurant for dogs.
Now, panel, to help Sandra win that $500, you'll ask one question about each of those stories. Let's start with story number one, that of the lint artist and Kitty.
Thank you. How big are your sculptures?
Right now, I'm just doing flowers and small animals.
David.
What was the strangest looking sculpture that you did?
I'm sorry?
The strangest looking, weirdest looking,
a
bizarre.
Squirrel.
A lint squirrel. Polly?
How do you make the lint stick together?
With glue and hairspray.
Ron.
Who gives awards for this?
I won first place at the Bering County Youth Fair for most creative art.
Okay, Sandra, you've heard Maggie's first story. Now, story number two, that of the drive-thru for animal food. Kitty.
Thank you. Does the dog have to be in a car to drive through?
I have had some walk-ups.
David.
What's the favorite food served in your restaurant?
Cheeseburgers and cheddar cheese french fries.
Polly.
Can people get fed in the restaurant at the same time?
No, it's strictly for dogs.
They don't order hot dogs, obviously. Where is this restaurant?
There's two outlets, one in Niles, Michigan, and one in Granger, Indiana.
Okay, now, Sandra, you've heard the cross-examination. Is Maggie a lint sculptor, or does she run a drive-thru for dogs?
Number one,
which is?
The lint sculpture.
So you think she's the sculptor of lint. If you're right, you win $500. Maggie, what is your true story?
To tell the truth, I run a drive-thru for dogs.
Oh, I'm sorry, Sandra. You were wrong, but we do have a very nice gift for you. And thanks for playing one-on-one.
Thank you very much. It was fun. I had a good time.
Thank you. Bye-bye. And Maggie, for stumping Sandra, you received $1,000. And congratulations. But we do have a little piece of videotape we'd like to show with one of your satisfied customers coming through. Have a look at this. That's the bone sign. And then what do they order? What's the food?
We have cheeseburgers.
Yeah.
Cheese fries, whole wheat fries.
How do they order?
The driver.
They just eat what they want. They charge them later.
And I also have pizzas.
Pizzas for doggies?
Right.
Right. And look, it's fantastic. Good luck with the idea, and thanks for playing one-on-one today.
Thank you
very much. And we'll be right back after these few words. Polly, thank you.
Thank you, Doc.
It was a wonderful week. Hey, Kitty, and see you again. I won't kiss you. Come on, you guys. Come on, break down. Ron and David, thank you also. It was a great week, and we'll see you all again next week. And that's it for the edition of Tell the Truth. Bye-bye.
Anything to Win, the new documentary series about people who refuse to lose. Tomorrow at 9, the Johnny Cochran story.
He never lost that passion. He never lost that itch.
Anything to Win, tomorrow night at 9, only on GSN.